Okay, I'm calling this meeting to order of Committee of the Whole on November 6th at 6:03 p.m. Good timing. Roll call.
Kuda.
Here.
Larson.
Here.
Boyd.
Here.
Maddox.
Here.
Hart.
Here.
Cobb. Russell. Oh, Russell.
Here.
So he's going to join us by Zoom?
Yeah, so I have a log in here. Sorry.
I didn't see him in.
And whenever he jumps on,
Okay, so can I have a motion by someone for executive session?
I'll read it.
Go to it. Two sections.
I move that we go into executive session to consider the terms of sale, lease, city-owned real or personal property, confidential information related to the marketing plan, specific business strategy, production techniques, trade secrets, or personal finance statement, financial statements of an applicant for economic development assistance, or to negotiations with other political subdivisions respecting requests for economic development assistance as necessary to protect the interests of the applicant or the possible investment or expenditure of public funds to be made in connection with economic development project.
Thank you.
Second.
Okay.
No way I could do that in one breath.
Yeah, no, it's true. Roll call, please.
Kuda.
Yes.
Larson.
Yes.
Russell.
Yes.
Boyd.
Yes.
Maddox.
Aye.
Hart.
Aye.
Okay, we're back out of executive session at 7:02.
Oh, wow. A lot of people waiting.
Okay. So, now we have a presentation on community engagement.
Did you want to just... And we'll do a full.
Yes, right.
Okay, we'll cover this in a full meeting. Okay, yes, we can move that then. So we'll shift that. We'll work with him on that. And that brings us to Noble Station. And the question is about putting this on for first reading. And the only thing that this does is it is an agreement to extend the time for them to go through this process and then see if we want to actually vote for their development agreement of something in the end that would be different than what we have. But all this does is allow the purchase agreement to go forward. They will not own it unless we vote for a development agreement. So this doesn't get them anything in time for till June 1st. Yes.
And also extended that tax credit opportunity for them.
Yes, extends the tax credit. If we don't vote on this, and this would just be first reading if we put it on the agenda, second reading would be on the 13th. If we didn't vote for it, the tax credit would expire. Okay.
Is there somebody from TWG here that could speak to what is going to be...
Yes.
Yeah.
Would you like to?
Go ahead, Alice.
Hey everyone, Alex Frazier here with DWG, and I see my face one too many times, but you know, we have really kind of taken steps to say, hey, we did this the wrong way. We need to get the community involved. We need to do this better. So with all that said, I think this is really kind of a complete blank slate redo, if you will, to try to make this project acceptable for neighbors and community. And we've got to do it differently. We've got to change. We've got to make this thing better. So, and I think that's why we're being requested more times. I don't believe we're at the point where we can still show more to make this better.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions?
If I may, real quick.
Yes.
Dennis Niebuhr on behalf of TWG Development. So what we're asking for tonight is ultimately with this ordinance is to extend the purchase agreement, the time period in the purchase agreement. As it currently stands, the development agreement would need to be executed by November 15th of this year. So all we're doing is asking for an extension of that time period from November 15th to the June date. And everything else, the development agreement still needs to come before this council. All administrative reviews of the plans, the site plan, the elevations, the materials, all that would still come before the appropriate bodies of the city. All this does is extend the period in which to execute a mutually satisfactory development agreement and proceed to closing on the purchase of the property.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
And could either of you explain how your negotiations with OFA allow you to do this project differently than the constraints that you felt were there before?
Sure. Turn that to Alex.
Yeah, so the building footprint can completely change. One of our biggest restraints that has been tough in working with OFA is when you get your award, they require you to have, it's 80% construction drawing, so basically ready to submit for building permit, which, you can have your opinions on that, but obviously that has not worked well for us because we were so restrained to changing that building footprint. So we haven't even gotten back to the point where we're gonna redo this design because we wanna make sure we have these community meetings so we can change the building footprint. It can be an L shape. You know, if we have to trim a couple units, we can change that. We really just kind of wanted to go back to the drawing board, get the new design team moving, and that's of course before, or that would come after we'd have additional community engagement.
Thank you. And could I just follow up with the staff?
You mean it was a question?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So how far along should a project like this be with planning commission and ABR before it comes to council for a vote? Like, could you put a percentage on that? I know that oftentimes after council will vote on a project, there's still gonna be another few planning sessions, maybe planning commission sessions and ABR, but how close to completion should those plans be before you bring it to council?
Well, I think this is part of a bigger discussion that we're gonna have, but
it probably is, yeah.
Less far along than maybe a lot of people think would be our suggestion.
So we'll save that for the broader discussion we're going to have about the planning process that's coming up.
Yeah, I mean, yes. I would apply this though to what we're talking about here and what our expectations ought to be down the road, because we're gonna get to that point.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I think I can respond a little bit to that question by saying that individual council members certainly are well within their rights as independently elected legislators to condition their votes on development agreements or purchase agreements as they see fit, you know, preferably within the bounds of, you know, the law. But when it comes to, you know, if a council member, any individual council member, needs to see substantially complete designs before agreeing to a purchase order instead of allowing the approval process to take place through Planning Commission, through Architectural Board of Review, so on and so forth, that council member is certainly well within their rights to vote no on any development, upcoming, development. I think the danger, though, is, again, when we are working with developers to improve and diversify the types of housing that we have, or other types of development, commercial development as well, expecting them to expend a great deal of money on detailed engineering and architecture without having some certainty that there's actually a purchase agreement in place or the expectation of a development agreement, we will find ourselves, as we have, I think, we've seen throughout the last 10, 20 years, being lapped by some of our competitor jurisdictions in the realm of development. I think, it's completely understandable that elected officials, politicians are concerned about getting calls about somebody not liking the design of this or that building. That's completely understandable. At the same time, there is a reason why this government, the council, created the approval bodies that we have in place, the Architectural Board of Review, which council appoints all the members of, and so presumably council has some degree of faith in their capabilities and qualifications to make the decisions about approving a variety of designs. But if the council begins determining, or taking into consideration those determinations before agreeing to move forward on, the myriad possible development opportunities that we'll have in the city, we might find ourselves telling developers to go elsewhere. So that's a danger that we face. I recognize that it can be off-putting and uncomfortable to relinquish that kind of authority and allow a different board or commission to have jurisdiction over those issues when you're getting calls from people who are complaining about a particular development. And this isn't specific to this development, just generally moving forward on development issues. And so that's the concern. When the director said less than you might think, or less than people might think, in terms of how substantially complete those processes need to be before a council in a jurisdiction that is pursuing development, before a council agrees to a development agreement or a purchase agreement for a property, I think I can explain that a little bit further and say most of the time those processes are not done. And in fact, the council process precedes the approval process when it comes to things like zoning, like the Board of Zoning Appeals, or when it comes to Architectural Board of Review. Those processes generally take place after council has done its work, or the substantial amount of its work. And so that's sort of, I think what you were getting at is the idea that you want to see, maybe, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but what your question seemed to imply was that you want to see sort of what the final product's going to be before you agree to it.
No, actually,
or you have a desire.
Actually,
you don't have to clarify
hold on,
just yet.
Hold on.
Just give me a second.
I do need to clarify.
Well, you can.
Just give me a second.
Just.
Yeah, I will.
And not specific to any particular council member, I can understand that there might be a general desire to see what you're approving sort of in its final form. But even that sometimes changes as a result of, unexpected circumstances. And so I think if we're going to actually pursue development in Cleveland Heights, may need to loosen the reins just a smidge.
Hey, Councilman Fuda?
Yeah, my question was not, when are we going to see something fully developed, the idea of the plans? That was not my question. My question was, what should our expectation be? When I turn to Director Zan, I'm looking for direction from staff on what we should expect to see before we vote. I'm not even saying what it ought to be. I'm saying, should we see, you know, 50% complete plans for a site plan and an architecture, or, you know, that's what I'm asking.
I guess what I would say in terms of that is that if I look at Taylor Tudor, that particular thing, we have
quite a bit.
But they haven't done the design. They haven't done a detailed drawings or anything. What we have is a rendering of what it should probably look like, you know, what's proposed to look like in general. It's not like it's detailed yet. Like, here's where the bathroom's going to go, and here's where, nothing like that. So, I mean, in that case, you feel more comfortable because you see, oh, that looks kind of good. And there was community engagement. People were asked to come and talk to them. And I think what we're probably looking for is comfort in knowing that there's sufficient community engagement and that what they're planning reflects that. Not that they have to have full drawings, but that, you know, we get some sort of a rendering. I mean, you want to know what you're getting, but not in detail necessarily. And it wouldn't have gone through ABR yet. ABR could also say, I don't like that window there, you know? Mr. Hicks, did you want to say something? Because I know you're participating.
Yes, Madam Chair. I wanted to just bring this point up, and the director is apt to correct me if I'm wrong. I believe that we're looking for this to be passed on first reading, because the it's up on the 13th or 14th of next week of the actual agreement.
Yeah, right? It won't be passed on first reading tonight. It'll be on first reading tonight, and we have a special council meeting. Well, if we make a motion to do it, then there would be a second reading if we did put this on the agenda. On the 13th, which is our special council meeting.
Oh, great.
Yes, Mayor.
Just for the public's edification on this, I did want to sort of clarify why this is happening in this way. In order to consider the extension that the development team has requested, council needs to, A, find someone who will sponsor the legislation on council, and B, vote to add this to the agenda as an agenda item. They'll be adding it potentially, if they vote to do so tonight, they'll be adding it to the agenda for first reading this evening. I don't know which council member is intending to sponsor the legislation. But that is the process that council would need to go through in order to consider this extension this evening and put it on the agenda for first reading, whether it was passed tonight or at the special meeting on the 13th.
Right.
So just to clarify the process.
Okay, so we're getting pretty late in the time. We're going to have to reschedule some things for another night. Is there anything further? Again, we have a motion on this. Or no? Motion.
Yeah, we have to have one. We haven't had one yet.
A motion. Yeah.
Yes.
No. Are we in agreement? People want to make a motion.
What's the motion?
A motion to add this.
Introduce
this.
You would do that.
You can do that in your regular meeting. You've got the agenda amendments.
Okay, we'll do it there.
Placeholder on your agenda. Yeah, I would recommend that.
Okay. Okay, that brings us to legislative review. Director, do you want to ask me? Do you want to go through anything? Anything you want to highlight?
Are there any questions?
Anyone have questions about the agenda? Yes, Councillor Larson.
For Director Unetic, resolution to contract with ADP.
Mm-hmm.
The legislation states that it would be, quote, more economical and in the best interest of the city and its residents to enter into an agreement with the contractor for payroll processing services. Then the cost of the services spread over 2 years is $245,367, which I did look up current salary ranges for payroll specialists.
Okay, well, first, I just want to go over something real quick. So, yes, year one of the contract is $106,000, and year two is $139,000. But the city, currently we have the payroll administrator doing two jobs. She's doing the payroll administrator job, and she's doing the treasury position. If we would go with ADP, I would eliminate the treasury position. And that's going to be saving us. So after I break those out, year one of the contract is only going to cost us a little bit over $33,000. And then year two of the contract will cost us a little bit over
$63,000.
Yes, go ahead. So nobody's losing their job.
No, I'm combining two positions into one.
Okay. And have you, do you have confidence in ADP that as a third party doing payroll, which is extremely important to everybody,
sure,
that they will provide strong customer service to the employees in the city of Cleveland Heights?
Yeah, yes. They're very reputable. They've been in business for over 7 years. They do several surrounding communities, and they do a very good job.
And will the services, have they gone online with so people can change their W-4 withholdings and their possibly any looking at the payroll stub, anything like that?
Yeah,
that they
yes,
can do
they,
online?
They do have that online.
All right, thank you.
Councilor, I just let you know, the employer that I have been employed with that is, I still do some work for, uses ADP, and I can do things online and I can look up my records and everything online, so it's a pretty seamless thing.
They've been around for a long time.
They've been around, yeah.
Long yes, time. I interviewed with them 10, 15 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Not deriding their service.
Right.
I just wanted to...
Director Yannetic, two questions. How long have we been without a treasurer?
So our former payroll person, they left, I think she left right around April.
Okay.
And then, so we promoted from within, and the treasurer person went into the payroll position. And then in the meantime, myself, the financial analyst, and the payroll person have all been sort of rotating between payroll and treasury. So it's taken away from my job and my financial assistant. And if we go with ADP, it would free up at least 110 man hours a month.
Mm. Yeah, that's significant. So I guess, you know, my only remaining question is, why not hire somebody to do this job and pay them, you know, and save $33,000 and $63,000 the following year? Why not find that right person? You know, we hear so much about outsourcing and privatization and so forth. So why this path?
It is extremely hard to find a person just dedicated solely for payroll. Those people really aren't out there, and if they are, they're not leaving.
You ain't find them?
Yeah.
Madam President.
Yes, Councilor.
I've been looking for an accountant and a payroll rep for over a year. They're very difficult. In fact, my current one is in Texas. Yeah.
Any further questions?
Just, I have a comment.
Okay, and then Councilor Larson after you.
Yeah, I think part of this is an effort to improve services. So in part, it's not just about the cost. It's about the quality and the consistency that we want to see, especially in payroll, because I think that's something that our core services are, you know, powered by people, and we want to make sure that those people receive as few missteps as possible when it comes to things like getting their paychecks on time. So that's one of the reasons. It's not just about the cost. I think it's important to note, as the director did just now, that it can be very difficult to find somebody who is dedicated to that and qualified and trained to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And as he said, it's taking a lot of staff time to sort of get all of those complicated systems working in the correct order. And so this is, frankly, you know, we'll be joining the company of, like, the county government who uses ADP. And I think that it's important for us to provide that quality service to our employees as well.
Okay, Councilor Larson?
Funded with unencumbered funds if we were doing this, or is it part of the budget?
It's part of the, so we wouldn't have to spend anything in 2023. It would be, first payment would be in 2024.
Okay.
And that is currently included in the budget. I just want to point out that this offer expires 11/22, and then it goes up like 20 or 30%. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have to get approved tonight, but if you guys do want to go this route, I would hope that you would approve it by the next council meeting, if not tonight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other comments? Oh,
well, you just
What did you want to comment on?
So,
this is another legislation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm 174. I just wanted to point out in section one, it says city manager.
Got it.
Okay. And then, I mean, I don't want to monopolize this, but I'm 180. Is it okay if we just kind of go in order?
Yeah,
of the
sure.
Legislation, it's just easier that way.
Yeah, that's fine.
So this legislation is about repairing the elevator at the Lee Road parking garage. How old is that elevator?
I don't know.
Does anybody know?
I would assume that it's probably as old as the garage, which is approximately 20 years, maybe a little less.
Okay, and it's $52,000 to fix it. Does anybody know how much a new elevator costs?
No, not in this room, I assume. And not for that particular location. We haven't gone out for bid for a new elevator system.
Well, Madam President?
Yes.
Interesting enough, Ohio Main Shop's elevator bill. So... Well, we had to figure out whether or not we were going to replace that or get a new motor to replace that motor. And it was about $70,000 or $80,000 was, I think, the cheapest quote that we got for that, just based on what we were dealing with. That
for helps. Repairs or for a new one?
For a new one.
And it's 52.
And that was the cheapest, and it did not meet all the requirements that we had. That was just to get something.
Basics.
Mm-hmm.
Is this?
Okay, it could be more than that.
Well... Is this first? Is this for passage?
Yes.
I mean, I'd really like to know if, I mean, if a new elevator is 70 and it's 52 to fix a 20-year-old elevator, I'd like to hear something about this beyond. I don't want to vote on it today.
Assistant Director Anderson, if you've got,
I guess the other consideration is that would add significant time to the repairs, and
yeah.
That elevator should probably be working today. And it's been out, and you know, I think there's probably value in having it operational sooner rather than later to the public.
Madam President, that was the other caveat. Months.
Yeah.
It takes, right now, we've been waiting 2 months to get the part for the motor, to build a new elevator. You look 6 months or so, just based on how things are shipping.
Additionally, Madam President,
yes.
Eventually, we will be turning over this garage and the responsibility of this garage.
True.
So I think that's an important consideration, and maybe we shouldn't take the time to, you know, go through an entire RFB process for a new elevator, and instead repair what we got. So
yeah.
We can provide the service, especially to, I mean, people right now who are dealing with mobility challenges. Every day that we don't have an operational elevator is a day that somebody with mobility challenges is really discouraged from shopping in the Cedar Lea Business District. And that's something that we want to get taken care of as quickly as possible.
I've gotten complaints on that from people. Because there's on the second floor, it's level.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where there's a lot of the handicapped parking, and the elevator doesn't work. So... Okay.
And this was additionally the reason why I am requesting that this be passed as, you know, immediately effective legislation this evening, or a request for consideration for passage this evening, because I don't think that there is, or at least I don't believe there should be, controversy about, you know, making the garage there more accessible.
Okay. You okay?
Yeah. I mean, but that's not the controversy. It's not the accessibility. It's how we're spending the money.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes, Councilor.
You have three pieces of legislation, first reading only for the Municipal Services and Environmental Sustainability Committee. Are you assigning those to committee?
They would go to Administrative Services.
Municipal Services, we're talking about.
Oh, you're talking about?
175, 176, and 177.
Okay, so they.
MSNS.
Oh, you're talking about the agreement with the County of Cuyahoga and Burns and Tehachapi? And 177, okay. Yes, I'll be assigning it to Municipal Services.
So I'll have to schedule a meeting because we canceled the 20th and we'll have to fit one in between now and.
Okay.
And then try to get it done.
Okay.
Madam President?
Yes.
I still have ordinance 128 and 129 for the CIC in my committee. Is there something else that needs to be added to that? We had to reschedule my meeting as well, so if there's something else.
There's nothing, it's not in here.
Just want to make sure. Okay, perfect.
Actually, Madam President, I noticed something. There's a discrepancy in 175, 2023. 175 is not intended to have emergency declaration language.
Okay. So we need to amend that.
I'm sorry, which?
175.
And what, where is it?
The emergency language.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's on for first reading only tonight? Right?
Correct.
Oh.
Yeah, so that can be amended for the second reading.
So additionally, 176 is not intended to have emergency declaration language.
Okay.
As you can see, they are removed from the short title in the agenda. They should not appear in the legislation.
Okay.
Madam President?
Yes.
177, are we passing that tonight? I know initially when we pulled this out of ARPA, my request is to get that done as soon as possible because they have a six-month window to get the ambulance.
We have to do a budget adjustment for that, so we're gonna do it on second because it's gonna be the budget adjustment at the 11:20 meeting.
Okay, got it. Just wanted to make, okay.
Okay.
Madam President, could.
Yes.
Can we go, on 175 and 176, is any of this covered by, because I see consent decree in here, is any of this covered by ARPA, the $18 million that we've already put towards ARPA funds? I mean, sorry, ARPA funding towards.
Towards sewer.
Towards sewer.
That may be something that we need to discuss in committee.
Okay, because there is a request for money on both of these, so I just wanted to know where the money's gonna come from. And then on 176, which is the resolution about Edgerly and Clarendon Roads.
No, 176 is.
Yep, that's correct.
That's right. I'm reading it. I've actually got it in my hand.
Oh, you're reading?
Yeah. I see we're spending money on an engineer. I guess my larger question is, I know, am I correct, Mr. Law Director, that some cities have an engineer, like a city engineer that works for the, and I guess what I want to know is how much do we outsource for these kind of engineering projects, and would it be more cost-effective if we had a city engineer? Well, that's not really a Law Director question.
Say, let me answer the first part of that question. Yes, some cities have an employee called city engineer.
And then, Mr. Mayor, if you want to answer that.
I don't, but if you'd like to bring your question to Councilor Larson's Municipal Services Committee meeting, I'm sure that we can have some answers for you about why the city of Cleveland Heights has historically gone with GPD Group as our contracted city engineer.
Yeah.
Instead of attempting to attract, retain an individual staff member that has that title.
Well, that's my question. Thank you.
Yes, Counselor.
May I have Addie coordinate with your office so that I can have somebody from staff at that meeting or yourself, if either way you think you want to do it?
Well, just for some clarification, were you anticipating holding Municipal Services Committee meeting next week before the second reading that we would hope to anticipate the week after?
Yes, I think that's what I have to do because the 20th is really full. So okay. It would be next week.
Then please, yes, certainly we can coordinate with.
Thank you. Thanks.
Any other questions on legislative review? Okay, given that, and we're 5 minutes over.
You know what, the one question I didn't get to ask, remember we were in the zoning committee meeting? It was 150, and this is for Director Sam. I'm gonna have to really, really hustle here. Okay, I don't know if you still have this. Okay, so I think this is the one I did not ask you about. 150, right? I was asking you, I think 127.
Yes.
Okay, so, so it says here, the mayor is hereby authorized to administratively approve requests for outdoor dining. Is that the traditional way it's done?
Yes, because that is contained within chapter 110, which is city disposition.
I will admit I did not look at that. And then second, what about, you know, with all these shared spaces, what about the idea of moving around with adult beverages from one place to another? You know, when you have...
Dora.
Dora, thank you. I can remember that.
Yeah, we've been exploring Dora's.
Dora the Explorer. and so, no, just no conclusion yet, but...
It might be coming forward.
Okay.
But that would be independent of these shared spaces. The shared space could be available.
Okay, so that would be something that would be included in an agreement.
Right, that's separate legislation to establish a Dora and the rules, the boundaries, et cetera.
All right, and lastly, on page 6, 130, 1321, 01, talks about no person shall construct any fence on a residential property without getting a permit if it's residential or commercial, and then there's different fees. Is there a requirement to notify the neighbor? I don't see that in here. Where, you know, the fence is coming up, should, whether it's residential or commercial. I see the requirement is to have the permit, but what about?
In most cases, it requires some sort of approval body, which does require noticing.
I see. I'm not gonna make it. So, like, commission, or is it a?
It could be the Architectural Board of Review or Board of Appeals. Those are the two that typically touch it.
So that happens when you just get the permit?
When you apply for the permit, they say when you need to get this approval first.
Okay.
And then the noticing happens.
All right.
That's interesting.
All right. I'm satisfied.
Yes.
There's some clarification on that as well. There are some that, while they require a permit, don't necessarily require the approval of an approval body. In that case, there wouldn't necessarily be a mandatory notification of various neighbors of any particular property.
It's very common. I would say it happens often, but not 100% of the time.
Okay.
Is that helpful?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Okay, so that's it for the questions on that. We are late, so.
Oh, sorry, go ahead. Yes, on 179, I don't see the tiny village on it at all.
We didn't, that wasn't moved forward, that is still under consideration.
I don't recall that.
I have to go back, I noticed. Wasn't it within a category?
Correct, but it was not as a definitive. This was, it was still under consideration as far as I was aware. The tiny home village was not decided upon to be included in this particular piece of legislation. It's still under consideration.
Right, there was a category that it was in.
That's what I think.
We did a category.
It was a category.
We did a category.
I'm sorry, I don't want to mention the category. Yes, it's under a cat, like everything's under a category.
I mean, it had multiple things under that category, didn't it?
Yes.
Let me pull this up.
Of which I think tiny villages was one.
It was. It was highly recommended.
And parklands, yeah.
It was highly recommended by y'all.
So I had put it under, if you see the notes. I mean, you see the reserve funds, they asked for 1.3. That was the additional 1 million we did not allocate already.
Oh, okay, okay, but we did allocate a million elsewhere.
No. No, we did not. It's still under consideration if you.
That's what I thought.
Okay.
If you look at the mass sheet I have at the end, oops. There's an allocation spreadsheet. Is that it? It's under consideration still with the remainder that we have left over.
Oh, yeah, we still.
Because we still have left over.
Yeah.
So was the three, so was the CIC under consideration as well? The 300,000?
Just the 300.
Just the 300.
Just 300?
Not the.
And the containers, the.
The shipping containers was separate of CIC, that was completely.
No, I'm trying to get a clarification. What was under consideration, which was not under consideration, or what were we waiting on?
Did you send out the spreadsheet on this?
I sent out the revised spreadsheet, but I might have sent it to you. But I thought I sent it to everyone.
That's the one I saw.
I don't remember if I saw it.
No.
I don't remember.
So I have still under consideration Pocket Parks, north of Mayfield, Tiny Village, Future Heights Local Business Outreach Program, Journey Center for Healing, Domestic Violence Court Advocate, Journey Center for Healing Validity Assessment, Training for Law Enforcement, Journey Center for Healing Pilot Program that we talked about, Belfair JCB, Peacemaker, and additional monies for Peacemakers. Those are what I still have under consideration.
So we have still some work to do.
We do still have, yeah, we have another 800,000.
First reading tonight, so we should be okay to making sure that we know.
Just the first reading.
Yeah, it's just the first reading.
It's first reading.
I would expect probably three readings on this as well.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Because, yeah, it was some things that we did talk about under consideration.
We're going to have to, we're going to have another meeting in terms of the remainder.
Yes.
So save your November and December.
And could I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
And I, you know, I hope everybody's listening. We don't know what's going to happen in the budget hearings. I mean, not exactly what's going to happen. We may want to have some monies set aside, talking about ARPA funds, so that we have the discretion to do something that maybe doesn't get done in the budgeting process.
That's true.
I don't know, I'm not predict, that's, this is not by any means a prediction of, you know, things might not go well, or, you know, I mean, it's not that at all. It's just, budgeting is always about priorities, and sometimes things that, you know, you wish could be part of a priority don't make it in the budget process. So, you know, having something left over to do some initiatives that, you know, perhaps.
Well, certainly, like if there's more infrastructure needed or something.
Just something to think about.
So anyway, we'll talk, we'll send out a poll in terms of scheduling another meeting for ARPA. Okay, so we are late. It's almost a quarter till. So we'll move other things that are on the agenda to another meeting and
Before you adjourn, please, could I just want to pass out the legislation that we discussed at our my committee meeting just for council members to review and maybe come back to the committee on the whole to.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Did you have one?
Okay. So this meeting is now adjourned at
7:42.
Sorry, 7:42.
Oh my God.